How did he say it? By God?
By God.
By God.
Good God.
Good God.
Yeah. Good God.
Okay, great. Here he is right now. To me, the greatest voice in the history of wrestling, good old JR Jim Ross. JR, how are you, sir?
I'm good, guys. How's it going this morning?
Doing well, man. Doing well.
Good.
Got the. I'm going to be honest with you. I'm sure a lot of people BS you all the time. We just got the book this morning, but I'm telling you, when it comes to books, there's only a couple that I like to read, and it's wrestling books and business books, oddly enough.
Yeah, the wrestling books.
And what do you know? I flip over the book, and I'm reading the different blurbs that folks put on the back. You've got The Rock. You've got Chris Jericho. You've got Billy Gibbons from ZZ Top. Bob Stoops from Oklahoma, your team. And then Mark Cuban, who I've read every one of his books. How do you two know each other, you and Mark Cuban from Shark Tank and Mavs and all that?
Mark has a TV network called Access, Access Television.
Yeah.
It used to be called HDNet.
Uh-huh.
And on Friday nights on Access TV, I voice over with Josh Barnett, the first, the youngest UFC heavyweight champion ever. Mm-hmm. I like to say that.
Yeah.
And just did. And he and I voice over New Japan Pro Wrestling. It airs on Access TV on Friday nights. So Mark owns the network. We've become friends. He likes my work, and I love his money.
Good.
That sounds good to
me. Well, and he knows how to make it. I mean, that guy is legit. For somebody who thinks you can't make it in America anymore, just read some of Mark Cuban's books. Absolutely.
Yeah, the optimism involved. Plus, he goes out on limbs a lot, like, who's bringing New Japan Pro Wrestling to the States?
Right.
Mark Cuban and Access TV. And Jim Ross, maybe you could speak a little bit on the footing that New Japan is gaining in the United States right now. I mean, they're even running shows in California sometimes.
Well, we televised two of their events in July 1 and 2 in Long Beach. They're looking at expanding their footprint, just like WWE has expanded their footprint globally. And I think, there's plenty of room for competition and plenty of room for everybody to get a slice of the pie. But make no mistake, there's one NFL. Whether we love them or we hate them, there's only one major league, and everybody that's in this business at some point in time deserves the opportunity to work for the biggest company, and that's WWE. So, but there's plenty of room for them. I support them all. Hey, a lot of my friends work for different companies, and what the hell? Let's let everybody make a living.
That's a great, and it leads. That's the thing, JR. I've got zillions of questions, and I know they're going to be bouncing all over the place. But you mentioned New Japan, and I'm a fan of the Young Bucks. I like the Bullet Club. I like all that stuff. Do you think with what they're doing? They go out to get their own T-shirt deals, merchandise deals. They're everywhere as far as the merchandising goes. Are those guys working themselves into getting into WWE, or are they hurting their chances?
Oh, I don't think they're hurting their chances at all. You know, I have my new podcast comes out tonight at 9 Eastern on Podcast One.
Yeah, the Ross Report.
And I actually talk about that a little bit, about the alleged controversy when the Young Bucks invaded a WWE Monday Night Raw taping in California a couple weeks ago, where it was.
Yeah.
And I just think it got them noticed. You know, somebody said, you think McMahon's all pissed off? I said, by the next morning, unless somebody reminded him of it, it's already gone. He's moved to the next deal.
He's on to the next thing.
He's on the next. It's time to go. Next.
Yeah.
So, but I think those kids, the Young Bucks, are very entrepreneurial.
Yeah.
And I fully expect with their skill set, and their fan following that they're building, they're going to bring an audience with them, and I think someday they'll definitely be in WWE. Don't know when,
yeah,
but it's inevitable in my view.
Yeah, I'd love to see. And the business acumen, you know, talking about Mark Cuban, those guys doing something I've never heard of another wrestler doing, and that's getting their merchandise worldwide, but they're not WWE, and I don't remember that ever happening.
They got it in the stores. They got Hot Topic at the mall.
Hot Topic everywhere. Yeah. With the book, JR, the brand new book just came out today, Slobberknocker, My Life in Wrestling. I'm opening up, as I said, I hadn't got to read it yet, but the pictures, dude, and the pictures are some that you think in this world of the internet, I've seen that picture. The pictures you have of Dusty Rhodes, for instance, are amazing. To me, Dusty Rhodes is probably, without a shadow of a doubt, my favorite all-time guy. I'm going to when I was a kid.
Yeah.
with the legacy that Dusty Rhodes left behind, you know, two sons that are just great professional wrestlers, talking about the Gold Dust and Cody. Mm-hmm. Do you think Vince McMahon has some axe to grind with the Rhodes family? Because he hasn't been always so pleasant when coming to deal with those guys. Anything that you know of with that?
I don't think so. I think I would know. You know, Dusty and I are, well, we're joined at the hip. We're buddies. Yeah. And I love him, and we did a lot of work together. Anytime you get involved in a system, mm-hmm. in a genre like pro wrestling,
yeah.
there's going to be a lot of subjective decisions made. Mm-hmm. It's creative. Is there really any right or wrong way? Yeah. What's the best color? What's the best shade of blue? Mm-hmm. That kind of stuff. It's all subjective, man. So yeah. Dusty was a decision maker and established president and creative in a lot of companies. He was unable to do that in WWE because they had somebody that did that job who owned the company. Mm-hmm. So I don't really think that there were philosophical disagreements at times, sure.
Yeah.
But I've had them with Vince and other promoters I've worked for. Mm-hmm. Sometimes when you're a player, you don't agree with every play that's called.
Right.
But you're obligated to go out and run the damn play to the best of your ability. And that's kind of how I've lived my life is if you're paying me, mm-hmm. I'm going to do my damn dead level best to give you everything I got.
Yeah.
And that's the way it's got to be.
It's the way it should be, JR. Absolutely, it should be. The book, Slobberknocker, again, My Life in Wrestling, I cannot wait to read it. But here's what I'm wondering as a lifelong fan of professional wrestling, JR, are there any good wrestling stories left that hardcores haven't heard? You know, with all these shoot interviews and podcasts and stuff, I mean, are there any other Jim Cornette, Dairy Queen stories left that we haven't heard yet?
There's going to be stories in that book. There's going to be a lot of brand new information.
Good.
Okay.
Good. I'm going to talk about things in my life that I've never had the courage to discuss publicly before.
Good.
And there are obviously stories behind the scenes that I think people are going to enjoy. So, you know, heck, I don't know. You make a good point, though, with all the internet and all the ways to communicate. Hell, you can't. It's hard to. The old adage used to be telephone, telegraph, tele-wrestler.
Yeah. Yeah.
And now you just tell the internet machine.
It is done. I know.
Easy as that. So what made you? How long were you working on the book, and what made you decide it was finally time to write this book, Slobberknocker, Your Life in Wrestling?
When I left WWE in 2013, I was kind of on my own, I was on my own, and I had a decision once I left the company from. My car ride from Stanford to LaGuardia in New York City.
Yeah.
I said, well, I can either retire or reinvent. And I decided within about 10 seconds to reinvent. So I need a project. So I said, well, maybe I think my book would be marketable. I got great stories. I've had a unique life. No one has ever had my job description mm-hmm. that's written a book. No one has ever had my job description, period, in the history of the genre. So maybe my stories will be unique. Maybe fans can relate to me better than they can relate to, say, Ric Flair, because I'm an average guy.
Oh, yeah.
You know, that kind of deal. So I decided to do that, and then we started writing. And then, of course, I mentioned last fall, in October, my writing partner, Scott Williams, passed away. And he had written Terry Funk's book and Bill Watts' book, and he was really great for me. And then Scott unexpectedly passed away. Then that was October, and then then in March my wife died. So I got killed in a car accident. So I almost didn't finish it because I just felt like it was jinxed. It wasn't meant to be, but I overthought it.
Yeah.
And I think that's one of our problem systematic issues in our society. Sometimes we all overthink stuff.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So the book's out. I'm proud of it. It's a hell of a read, I believe, and I think folks are going to enjoy it. They're going to cry. They're going to read it. They're going to get tears in their eyes. They're going to get laughter. Yeah. They're going to get, oh, I didn't know that. Oh, I understand now. I understand. I get that. So there's some good stuff in it that I'm just really proud. It's been a great journey, guys.
Well, we're going to pass it around. We're going to read them. We're going to enjoy them thoroughly because it's going to be what, years and years of stuff we've all enjoyed. And, man, I'm sure Jan would be proud of it too, Jim.
That's a beautiful picture of the two of you in there. I mean, that's, you know, I can't wait to read it. I can't wait to, I will finish it today. I guarantee it because I cannot wait. I'm telling you, JR.
Jump on in.
I'm impressed, man. I'm impressed. Well, hey, it's at Barnes & Noble and Books A Million and Amazon's doing a hell of a job of getting it in everybody's hands. So it's wherever books are sold, I'm told. It's e-books, audio books, hardcover, it's all there. So I can tell you guys, reading my own book, after my wife passed and reading how we fell in love and how she helped me build my career was the most challenging thing I've ever done as a talent. To read my own book and read about those passages were very, very, I was very conflicted, to say the least, reading them. So it's available in all the stuff, all the levels and all the platforms, and I'm just very proud that we were able to finish it. And I think people are going to say, J.R., you guys wrote a hell of a book.
J.R., when they made you and Gordon Solie, they broke the mold, sir. They broke the mold. And I'm glad they did, because you're one of a kind, and it's our honor to talk to you again. We encourage everybody that loves wrestling and loves football. I mean, everything's in here. Everything's in here. Slobberknocker, mm-hmm. My Life in Wrestling. J.R., God bless you, sir. I hope to talk to you again down the road.
Thanks, fellas.